Yeah. And what made it even worse, Garf Garrett, with his pants around his ankles and his droopy checkered boxers, standing on that waterbed, out of my mind. And Zabby holding that knife. But you don't know that part. I would never tell my kids this. They think I'm at my book club. Yeah, I'm at a book club. So that summer, there was a contest on the radio. I was going to win it. Whoever could come up with the best name for the horse with no name would win, no lie, a horse. Yeah, you had to send the names in on postcards, like one name per postcard. So I pre-addressed and stamped 90 postcards. I was going to win that horse. On the first part of the journey, I was looking at all the life. There were plants and birds and rocks and things. There was sand and hills and rings. And nobody knew what that meant. But still, we sang a song. You know, and every single day that summer, I sent in a new name, the horse with no name. Cause I've been through the desert on a horse with no name. It felt good to be out of the rain. God, that was our anthem. You know, if we knew what an anthem was, it was the thing we sang before doing it. It being the thing we would not be doing if the three of us were not together. Zabby and Skinny Lenny and me. Vying, testing, erupting, egging each other on to greatness, to infamy, to getting our asses kicked, like sneaking into Zabby's parents' pub, because they actually had a pub inside the basement of their house. And we would mix drinks out of whatever was open, and it didn't matter. You know, Jack Daniels, sure, Strawberry Hill, why not? Peppermint schnapps, gin, didn't matter. Because we're 13. See, we hate the taste of all that shit, but it doesn't matter. Because we're 13. Yeah. Oh. So we mix all that together. The brown and the red and the clear stuff that makes my nose sting and my eyes water. Plus some orange juice for body. And we pour it into an empty tennis ball can. And we drink, holding our noses, and it is awful. It is god awful. But taste is not the point. No, see, taste is the last thing we care about. God, I was a good girl. I was an outstanding student, the perfect child of miserable parents. So corruption fodder. What class do you have right now? Zabby says. French. Well, you're gonna be late to your French class. I'm never late. Well, today you're gonna be late. Everybody knew her. Abby Zilker, Zabby. She was newly notorious because a fist fight on the bus with Tanya Yonkers had gotten her suspended for 3 days. And even though Zabby had this big red ball patch where Tanya had yanked a bunch of her dirty hair, it was pretty much agreed that Zabby won. You know, Tanya's crying, no one's really concerned because she's a bossy crybaby. So, and now Zabby's back at school and she's talking to me and I'm terrified and then slightly honored. Better hurry, you're gonna be late to your French class. Hey, can you please give me back my French book? Uh-oh, was that the bell? Oh my God, give me back my book. Well, it looks like you're late, huh? What are you gonna do? Well, you're late too, idiot. So what? So we're gonna get in trouble. If you get 3 tardies, you get a detention, and one more after that, you get suspended. And if you get 3 suspensions, you get expelled. How many tardies have you had, Frenchie? None, I say. Well, I've had 5. 5? This week. You can get expelled. Oh no, really? Okay, just shut up and give me back my book. Oh, hey, look, it's the assistant principal. Do bring you more raisins this morning, but my rabbit died, so no more raisins. We spent the rest of the afternoon, it's what you think it is, we spent the rest of the afternoon sitting in the assistant principal's office. God, Abby was everything I was afraid to be. She was irreverent and outrageous, attractive and funny, and she could even dance like she was black. You have to remember, this was a time when all the white people were doing disco, and we just looked even harder. I mean, Zabby was an influence. Zabby, why did your parents find out? That's skinny, Lenny. We're sitting in Zabby's parents' pub making a carafe of our disgusting magical elixir. They won't care. They're at a party. Skinny Lenny is pouring drinks. Whoa, that's way too much of the brown stuff, Lenny. Okay, I'll balance it with more of the clear. She just sort of fell into my life, Skinny Lenny. No, she like legit just fell off her bike in front of my house. She was funny that way. Completely accident prone. It's actually notable how many near-death encounters she survived. Wonder she didn't die sooner. Yeah. Down the hatch. Bad. So bad. Handsome. Not nearly as bad as her brothers, Dean and Dono. Dean. Great looking. 22 or 19, I don't know, but too old to be a kid. We're hiding in the eucalyptus tree bent over the road, armed with stolen rotten eggs from the peepers. Expertly dropped bedded bombs on windshields and hoods and laughed till we wet our pants. Savvy, look who's coming. Dean's car. His manhood rumbling on the road below us. Me. One, two, go, 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 I shout. We pelt that macho station wagon with heartfelt hatred and joy and 13-year-old revenge. Miscalculation. It takes Dean no time to put two and two together. Arr! I mean, he's slamming on those brakes. That car has never moved so fast. We are skittering, laughing, screaming down the street, running in every direction. Dean crawls out of the passenger side because the driver's door is busted. Dean chases rotten egg into her face and her head. Dean grunts. Me and Skinny Lenny are tearing out of there. Skinny Lenny, of course, trips on a pothole and scrapes up her knee, her elbows, and her chin. And I stoop down to help her, but Dean's coming! Big Dean's smile on his face. Stop it, Dean! No, I didn't do it! Lenny lies. Don't, Dean! Don't! Stop! Mess, her mouth is filled with dirt, and he gets up looking for me, but I'm hell-bent running through somebody's backyard. He's yelling after me. I'm watching you, you bitch! You little bitch! I'll teach you to fuck with my car, squirt! He never did catch me that time. But he never did forget. Let's see. Sapphire. Shallow. Oh! Dark Lady. Been through the desert on a horse with a name. She doesn't sound good, but you know, that's what you do when the contest. Well, I did the boy. You know, Hitchcock, Elton John, Ringo.
Who both know?
Everyone's gonna look for the hidden meaning in the name. Destiny, Roulette, Fickle Finger of Fate. We were standing in Garth Garrett's driveway. Me, Zabby,
Skinny Lenny, Garth Garrett, and this little cousin of his. No, really, the cousin wasn't very tall. And he was just standing there with his hands in his pockets. He wasn't show-offy like Garth Garrett, who's always making like his family was rich, whatever. Anyway, the reason we had walked over to Garth Garrett's house was because of Garth Garrett. He told Dabby that he had gotten a bunch of weed. Hot shot. And he told her that he would give her some if she came over. So we're at this, you know, rich house, which was really just this dirty house, at the end of this hill, at the end of this long, winding road. And so we're standing there, not really listening. It's so obvious that he has a hard-on for Zabby, because everybody does. And Zabby cannot stand Garth Garrett. Nobody can. But she's wily. So we're standing there, not really listening, or caring. Hey, Zabby, are you going to Jeff Cranover's party? I don't know, maybe, are you? Well, you know, he invited me. Who cares? Did you go to his last party? I don't remember. Because he invited me to that one, too. Yeah, I'm having a huge party. Like, everybody can come. I can do whatever I want. My parents don't care. I just have to wait till they get back. Are your parents going to be at the party? No, Pinhead. They have to buy the keg. Where's the pot, Garth? Oh, the pot. Yeah, it's in my room. Well, go and get it, Garth. Hey, Zabby, ever been on a waterbed? Mm-hmm. I think Garth Garrett's a lonely guy. you have a waterbed? Hell yeah, California King with a heater, hot and wet. Creepy lonely. What do you say, Zabby? Come on, I'll show you. What? I'll give you the pot after you look at my waterbed, swear to God. Despite every screaming impulse, otherwise we follow.
Assaulting our eyes with his droopy checkered boxers. Skinny Lane looks
And that's when Cousin Dirk, with his hands in his pockets, starts snickering. You little shit. You don't have any, do you? Fucking Dirk! Yes, I do. I have a whole stash. No, you don't. You're a liar. Yes, I do. You're not getting any of it. Savvy pins Garth Garrett to the surging waterbed. I'm starting to wish I had a cup. What is it, Nickel Dick? Forget I don't have to give you any. I came to your house, fucker. Now, are you going to give me what you said you'd give me, or am I going to hit you? Maybe, slut. Oh, wait. I don't think I remember to tell you that Zabby was a competitive swimmer. National Junior Olympics champ. Butterfly backstroke. All that strength in her shoulders and her arms. So when she punched Garth Garrett in his stomach, I felt sorry for him. Kind of. Oh, you crazy ugly whore. Now you're really not getting any of it. Don't tell him where it is, Dirk. It's in his asshole, said Cousin Dirk. Shut up, Dirk. Well, I guess we better check. No way you win. You're too chicken. Skinny Lenny sits on his legs. I sit on his arms. And Zabby starts pulling those droopy checkered boxers down. Now I close my eyes because I so don't want Garth Garrett's penis to be the first one burned into my mouth. Instead of feeling unpopular at this moment, Garth Garrett seems pretty turned on. He is twisting and groaning, and the bed is roiling and tossing us around. What are you doing to me, huh? Come on! And that's when Zabby picks up that steak knife. Turn over, perv. Weirdly, he does. What are you gonna do now, huh? And he closes his eyes and smiles. Cousin Dirk says, "Aw, man, I think your parents just rolled in, but Garth Garrett doesn't hear or doesn't care." Zabby grips that knife. She's freaking me out, man. I mean, even Skinny Lenny's like. And she takes that knife and she plunges it into the waterbed. At first, no one says anything because we're all in shock. And then she pulls that knife out of that waterbed, and all hell breaks loose. The water is spouting, and Frank Martin spouting out, get out of my waterbed. Well, all right, but it's hard to move quickly on those things. I start laughing. I'm like, oh, no, let's get out of here. So we pile out the window over this bed. Skinny Lenny trips, falls on her chin. Her mouth is filling with blood. It's lucky she's got braces to keep her teeth in.
Next year when she's in juvie or jail or we're being sued in court?
where all of this is headed. Stop talking like such a jackass. Go to hell. You go to hell. How about I just go? And there she goes. My mother melts into a heap onto the floor. Cataplectic fit. Limp man syndrome. It's not the first time, and it won't be the last. It's fine. You get used to it. It's fine. Did you or didn't you steal from your mother? This was a gray area. See, about 3 months earlier, Favorite started having an affair with a guy that lived across the street. He had moved back in with his parents, and so now they were doing it. And he was 26, and she was 14. Yeah. And she didn't even know he was married until it just sort of popped out. Like, oh yeah, by the way. Anyway, it was disgusting, and I told her to stop, and she tried, but they were in love. Are you at least using something, like birth control? Her, silence. Oh my God, Carrie Ann. Well, I don't have money for that sort of thing. What are you thinking? Make him pay. He's between jobs. He just moved in with his parents. And he's a jerk, hello? You need to use birth control so you don't make a little jerk. He's not a jerk. Promise me you won't say anything. I would kill myself if Mom and Dad found out. See, I was pretty sure they would kill her first. So when I happened upon an envelope stuffed with cash in Mom's scarf drawer, what? I was looking for a scarf. And anyway, why was she hiding that much money? I instinctively took some so that Carrie Ann could get what she needed to not have the jerk's baby. But, and I swear this, there was no letter in that drawer. I didn't take the letter, Dad.
What letter?
Right, there wasn't one. So are you telling me you didn't steal?
No.
No, you didn't steal, or no, that's not what you're telling me.
I'm confused.
Are you a thief or are you a liar?
I don't know. Get the belt.
What? It's not even fair! Go get the belt. Look, Dad, I'm sorry, okay? I'm sorry. Well, you should have thought about that before you decided to become a lying thief. Like I said, the worst part of the belt was the waiting. The, pants part was pretty humiliating. And I frankly didn't know what I was supposed to be learning, except how afraid of my father I was in that moment. So I waited. I tried not to think about Garth Garrett with his pants around his ankles and his droopy checkered boxers. I couldn't help it. I didn't know anymore whose shame I was feeling. After it was over, my father, I think, trying to whip a little more out of me than the lying and stealing, like his wife's secrets and his daughter's shape-shifting and his lack of control over any of us. I didn't cry. Didn't give him that payoff. Grounded. Go to your room now. Me, silence. No grimacing, no whimpering. I cried hard into my pillow, under my covers, and I fell asleep. And when I woke up, the house was quiet downstairs, it was dark outside. My mother would be watching repeats, all in the family, good times, happy days. My father would be in his basement office, avoiding my mother. My sister would be having phone sex with her married boyfriend. Shit. I was dying. I had to get out. So the first year we moved into the unincorporated area called Cerro Vista Acres, there was a fire. The Santa Ana winds blew some idiot's campfire into these massive parched oaks and eucalyptus, and fire tore through regional parks and housing tracts and flew up into the hills where we lived. God, I remember my father waking me up in the middle of the night, me so sleepy he had to carry me through this dark house. My mother is grabbing anything she could carry, a photo albums and birth certificates, ashtrays, world book encyclopedias, you know, anything she could find, and throwing it in this cardboard box. So we go out to our car, and I mean, our street was this surreal movie. Neighbors driving by in packed cars, and everybody in PJs like us.
horses running in and out of the dark. Oh, so beautiful and afraid.
Horse crazy me, wanting to catch and ride every one of them through the dark, bareback. All that freedom and fear.
Well, what happened to them? Where will they go?
They'll be back, my father said. They know where home is. Down the street, goats and pigs are running across people's front porches, and the whole thing was made magical by these flakes of white ash falling from the night. I'm telling you this for a reason. So anyway, after the fire scare, we had regular drills at our house. Being at the top floor of a shake roof home, my father thought he should install an alternate escape route. So he put rope ladders into the gabled window seat and our bedroom. Perfect for a quick getaway. Which is exactly what I needed. He never did actually get around to showing us how you escape using a rope ladder. The favorite settled in as I was pulling this rope out of the window seat. We had Sloppy Joe's for dinner. I saved you some.
You're welcome.
You cannot climb out the window, dork.
Why, are you going to rag on me?
I'm sorry. Did I get grounded or did I get whipped doing something for you? You can't climb down that rope. You don't know how.
Well, maybe if you yell louder, Dad will come up and show me.
I'm not kidding. I'll tell. So will I.
He hasn't called me. I don't know what's going on.
He's married? He can't stand his wife. It's awful. She doesn't understand him. He's going to ask for a divorce. He just has to wait for the right time to do it.
Interesting.
Now, you don't know everything. I know he's a jerk and you're an idiot. That much I know.
You don't know. It's so messed up. I wish you understood how he made me feel and how nice he is to me. I can tell him anything and he doesn't criticize or judge me or make fun of me. He makes me feel smart, unlike some people.
Well, that's just stupid.
Because you don't understand and you might never understand. And I feel sorry for you. I wish you knew what this was like.
I wish. I know what it was like.
I just wish he'd call. I'm sure he'll call. He's probably just busy. Do you think?
So this rope ladder, that was more rope than ladder, was fairly certain the favorite was right. They'd find my broken corpse on the driveway in the morning. But the thing is, there weren't a whole lot of options. Okay, make yourself useful, Carrie Ann. Hold up the window. Hire! I'm not a lizard! So she holds up the window, and I'm feeding this rope through, and soon enough, the end that's bolted to the window seat is good and tight. Okay. All right. Okay, wish me luck. Good luck. You're gonna die. I crawl out the window onto the roof, terrified. Don't look out, whatever you do! Shut up! I can't watch! Racing against the roof with every body part, an inch my torso, fraction by fraction, toward the dangling ladder. Belly to rooftop, lowering my feet. Yep. And then my hips, and here it is, and then legs are. Okay. God. Little splinters of shake roof are piercing my thigh flesh. Are you there? Carrie Ann?
inch my way down the rope. A prayer for each knot, each second I don't die a gory death. I see the glow of the TV in the window as I shimmy past. Okay, my mother's head bobbing in silent silhouette. Okay, she tries to stay awake. Good, all right. Okay. I pass the broken hall window. Okay. Past the kitchen where the favorite pads with a bowl of Neapolitan ice cream. Stairs to my father's basement office where he hides from my mother. Oh my God, I'm alive! Oh, sweet freedom. I have no idea how I'm gonna get back in my house. Okay. But hey, Mom and Dad are never gonna know I'm gone. Right?
He always had this secret glee about him, like if you just put a potato in somebody's tailpipe. pipe and was waiting for it to blow. You know what I mean? Gleeful. He was kinder than me and Dane, more appealing in every way. Except he had a girlfriend, Tina White. But he always said hi to me. And he would give me the look. You know, like I know I'm in a stupid relationship, but you're probably someone special. You know, that kind of look. So I kept my feelings to myself for the time being.
Seat up?
actually touching the cups?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Where's the... Madonna is leaning into me. He's not talking. He's reaching. No, he's pressing against me. Oh, my God. This is happening. It's happening. I close my eyes. Do it. No boy has ever touched me, you know, there or anywhere. I close my eyes. Okay, relax. Breathe. Madonna reaches. I open my legs, and suddenly he releases a lever. The seat jerks forward, and I'm thrust toward the windshield. I'm right up in the wheel. Oh. Okay, you're all set. Have fun. Be good. And then he just leaves. And just like that, the passenger door slams. And we are driving. I am driving. You're going. It's getting linear in the back. It feels too big. The seat's too deep. But I'm driving down the street, down the boulevard. Wait, where are we going? Tasty Breeze. No, not Tasty Breeze, Lenny. First the liquor store. Okay, just tell me where to go. Okay, turn here. No, not here. You guys. You almost hit the policeman. The policeman. She's kidding. Amazing. The power and the freedom, the electric surge. The world is cracked open for us this night, and we will never be 13 again. So miraculously, no one dies. Except the car. Stupid piece of shit car. I mean, we've gone less than 5 miles and we're screwed. Well, what? Now what do we do? I mean, maybe we can walk to the Tasty Freeze. We're not going to Tasty Freeze, Lenny! God, Dean's gonna kill me. He's going to kill me. Well, maybe Donna can get the car before Dean kills you, I say. Maybe Donna will confess his love for me, I say. But anyway, so we get out of the car, and we're walking off the beaten path. We're in a rural suburb of the suburbs. I mean, it is dead quiet, pitch black. Hey, you guys, if we go over the hill, is it shorter, you guys? No way. We'd have to walk across Morningstar. Okay, well, whatever. Like, it's faster. It's also trespassing. Yeah, I heard they had electrified fence. Hi! Morningstar was Morningstar Ranch, this low-end horse sporting property. You know, notorious mainly because we'd never been there. But we just heard about it. So there were these stores. The end of the street. Nothing. Lenny, what are you doing? Lenny! Wait! Now! God, this doesn't seem like a good idea to me. Like, what if they catch us on their property? They're not gonna catch us. Let's go. We have to get the car home before Dean kills us. Let's go. Okay, let's go, Lenny. But, no. Skinny Lenny has pulled up a handful of grass and is running across this dark dirt patch or straight at this group of dark horses. Yeah, Lenny, shut up! She's crazy! I run after her, lighthearted. I'm laughing. I'm a sprite. I mean, unicorn. I'm cantering across this dirt and this grass. But wait, now I can't find... No answer, bad sign. Where is she? Lenny! I tripped! Over what? I say. Silence. Okay, Lenny, cut it out. We gotta go. Hey, are you okay? Silence. Lenny, quit messing around. You gotta go. And then, Lenny screams. She screams so loud, it sounds like a slasher movie. Like, she has to be faking it. They shut up! They, you idiot! They're gonna find us! And then all of a sudden, we're next to our cowering friend. We have all fallen. We've all tripped over. What is that? It's a horse. It's a dead horse. Oh, no, no, no. Bloated, stinking, stiff, a few days gone. A cougar attack, an accident, that happens, but this is different. The horse's front legs have been bound at the fetlocks with wire. And you don't do that unless you don't want them to move, and you never use wire. This was no accident. The entire 2 hours it takes us to go back over the hills, cut through backyards, down our street, back to Savvy's house. When I get home, the house is quiet and dark, which is good. I crawl through the broken hall window just before dawn. I drink sparklets from a Dixie cup. Upstairs, I throw my filthy self onto my bed. My heart hurts. And crap, we need to replace the liquor. And I cannot stop thinking about that dead horse. Bloated and stiff, its wire tied legs, and how it must have suffered before it died. Separated from the others, helpless and bad. And all I was trying to do was break away. I have a new mission in life. Save the Marine Star horses. And then all of a sudden, my door flies open and my mother comes in. Where in God's name have you been, Missy? Mom, hello, privacy. You could have been dead in the road. You could be lying dead in the road somewhere. Okay, well, I'm not, I'm sorry. You could have been raped or murdered or mutilated. Mom, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm sorry. Does Dad know I snuck out? No, your father went out. He's out where? To get ice cream. What do you think? Look, I need to talk to you about your sister. Oh, no. Does Harry even talk to you? Do you and she talk? About what? Is she okay? Part of me wants my mother to drag this out of me, the whole ugly mess with the affair, with the neighbor, and Carrie Ann's increasing torment, and not because I'm mad at the favorite, but because nothing good can come from something that lame. I'm scared for her, you know? But then, another part of me knows that telling me the worst thing I could do. There is something. I knew it. She's upset. Is she upset with me? She's upset with me. Cataplexy is not arbitrary. A cataplectic fit hits my mother when she experiences big emotion. laughing or crying or thinking stressful thoughts. It's kind of like watching a heavy snow fall on a weak tree. One minute you're standing there, and the next everything just sort of bends. My mother tips into my arms, and I tuck her into my bed. You didn't let her. It's there. Well, I did steal her money, so I figured it kind of evened out. Oh, you found it? Do not climb the window or you're grounded. Well, I am grounded. Good. Good night. Is Dad coming back? Mother. I was in the favorite's bed the next morning. My mother was still asleep in my bed, and my father was nowhere to be seen. Wait, so you found the letter in Mom's scarf drawer? It was filled with all of the things he wanted to do to her. It was worse than disgusting. Oh my God, you mean like torture? Like sexually. To her, on her, with her, using his fingers, his tongue, his toes, anything you could think of. She's leaving us. Our plan takes place over the phone because I am still grounded. We're gonna need a bunch of halters and ropes. Okay, Zabby, like how many? Like 20 or something.
20?
Yeah, that's what Zabby said. How in the heck are we supposed to get 20 halters? Wire cutters, blankets, gloves. Hey, Lenny, can you get a bunch of blankets? I think so. I don't know. Wait, let me check. Mom? Buckets, apples, carrots. Do we have any blankets we don't need? What are we doing this?
So what are you girls doing?
Sometimes Donna answers the phone when I call for Zabby. Oh, come on, Zab. She wants to. She's a big girl. Tough ball. Shut up. then she leaves. And then it's just me. And Dee. Closing the door. I've been waiting for this for a long time. You probably knew that, didn't ya? Yeah, you did, sweet little bitch. My fingers are stuck together. I'm swallowing my spit. That's when he makes his move. Clamp! His mouth is huge over mine. His lips are hard. His tongue is surprisingly pointy. It's filling my mouth. I can't breathe. Why do people like this? I stop feeling. I stop thinking. I'm hovering, watching myself pretend to know what to do. His forklift tongue is gouging out my mouth. This is wrong. It's wrong. I'm a terrible kisser. Hang in, and I hang on. And then I start to feel something. Not pleasure, but hunger. I don't like Dean. But I like this. I like kissing. And he moans and touches my breast.
Oh my god, it is the weirdest thing.
It feels so stupid and so good that my black gets muffled in his mouth. What? Oh, nothing, just nothing. And every delta, huh? And so then I watch him fill me up. First one boob, then the other, squeezing, pressing, rubbing. I mean, it's okay, I guess. But I want to kiss, so I clamp my mouth on his and slip my tongue through those lips. It's like a slip and slide in there. And then he moans, and that's when I realize I'm not a bad kisser. I'm a good kisser. Oh my god, Dean's a bad kisser, that's what? How am I going to tell him that I love his brother and not him? And then I'm just using him for kissing practice. Oh, I start to feel sorry for him. You know, it's really hard to make out with somebody without feeling sorry for them. And Zabby's seeing you hanging on the door. Time's up, Spaz! And Zabby comes bursting in the room. Time's up, dear. I'm not kidding. Go, okay. She's ugly and doesn't know how to kiss anyway. Tonight is bigger than deep. It's after midnight at this point. Donna was promised to drive us to Morningstar in one of his crap cars for another $20 we don't have. And if this thing is going to happen, it's going to happen tonight, but Donna is nowhere. Oh, hey, by the way, you guys, I didn't find very many halters. Okay, well, how many did you get, Lenny? None. What the hell? Well, I mean, what about ropes? We gotta have ropes. And I say, well, I have four ropes. How are you leading all these horses? Well, I guess we're leading four horses because that's how many ropes we have. Where is Donna anyway? Oh, he's probably fighting with his girlfriend. Oh, I would not want to fight with Tina White. Tina is mean to the max. Yeah, she could totally beat him up. Oh, hey, did you bring gloves?
I have a pair of Playtex rubber gloves. See? They're yellow.
Playtex. The rubber will keep us from getting electrocuted. Just in case. And then all of a sudden we're in headlights and a car is slowing down. I think, is it? Yep, I have a feeling. And it's him. It's Donna. Okay. I try not to be stupid. It's cool, but everything in me is busy. Okay. Hey, hi. And Daddy says, hey, nice of you to join us, Donna. But he's not saying anything. He's just staring at the steering wheel. I'm going home. I'm beat. Okay, what about driving us to Morningstar? Not tonight, kiddo. Sorry. You're too tired to drive us 5 miles? Why, you're a dick? Maybe I am a dick. You are a dick! But he's staring at the steering wheel. Doesn't take the bait. Definitely are, Dono! Hey, Zabby, it's cool. It's fine if he
eyes are round and soft.
He's looking at me like... He's looking at me. Do you know how pretty you are? Tina's pregnant.
Oh. And that was it. He drives away slowly. The girl that won the contest that summer, she was from Bakersfield. And I didn't know they had horses in Bakersfield. Amirage, that was the winning name. Amirage, okay, because it's whatever, it's a real name. We're walking. We were at Morningstar with our rubber gloves and our ropes and our plan, our really, really stupid plan. Hey, you guys, wait a second, you guys. Starlight falling on the hills, it's like a dark day. It's too bright, it's too easy to see, but no, we're going through the unelectrified barbed wire fence. Skinny Lenny somehow managing to get her hair caught. Wait, you guys. We're clucking and cooing. Here we show. Oh, two of them trot away. You have to go slow. Oh, hey, here, horsey. Here. Zabby somehow manages to get her rope around the neck of a mangy bay mare. Lenny is stalking a zippered buckskin and a greedy palomino. I just stand there. What's the point? Can't save them all. And then warm breath is on my neck and my ears. Feel great if it wasn't a horse and I wasn't scared. Young, probably green, super friendly. It likes me. I don't know why I don't have any carrots. Oh, it's nothing to me. Oh, it's so sweet. Whoa, hey! Whoa, whoa! Skinny Lenny sort of being led around by her horses. And Zabby's just trying to get the bay mare to move. But the Appaloosa. let's go. And we're going, and they're not going to follow us because we have a head start. And they can't because their stupid truck doesn't fit through the fence. Shit, they jumped out of their truck. They're running straight for it. Fucking fuck. Shut it. Let's go. Let's get out of here. No way, Zabby. I say I'm not letting go. And the guys are yelling something about jail and our asses. Zabby's getting Lindy. You're saying, what are you doing?
Why would she take so many pills? Does Carrie Ann talk to you? Do you two talk? I sit next to my mother on the couch. She puts her head on my shoulder and we watch Carrie Ann sleep. Did Carrie Ann tell you about George? He got bad news today. Very bad news. Cancer. Fast moving. Terminal. He has maybe 2 months to live. That's fast. He said he just couldn't do that to me. And then I look up and I look at my mother and I see that desperation and I say, would you leave us? Her silence. Missy, you could be dead in the road. You could be lying dead in the road and I'd be sitting here. I'm not dead. I stole a horse. And the Morningstar people caught me and called the police, and I think they're pressing charges. Why? Well, because it's illegal to steal. Why would you steal a horse tonight of all nights? In 6 months, when my mother is out shopping, she'll run into George.
be with another woman. He won't have a lot to say. My father comes up from the basement. I offer to get the bell, but he just shakes his head no. Goes back down to the basement. Okay. People never did press charges. I knew we knew about that dead horse. They said it had been inadvertently hobbled. Yeah, whatever. But they did close down within that year. And I like to think we had something to do with that. That's how we knew we had been through something real. Something that changed everything. We weren't freedom fighters, we were freedom takers. Clutching fistfuls of it like things of air, like starved spirits. That's how I remember. That summer we agreed to, no matter what, meet back at the Tasty Freeze every 10 years. And, well, it's not a Tasty Freeze anymore. I keep coming back. I keep thinking that right after high school, Zabby got married and got religion. We lost touch. And I guess she's still married, so loves Jesus. She may even be the mother of teens like me. Corruption father. Irreverent, erupting, searching,